a doctoral degree in that, so you don't go to medical school. So the real difference is psychiatrists have been to medical school, psychologists have not.
Okay. Would you explain to the jury your training that got you to be a licensed physician and any board certifications?
Sure. So after college, I went to the University of Pennsylvania for medical school. Then I did a one-year internship in a hospital in San Francisco. It was just general medical practice. And then I went to psychiatry residency for 3 years. And then I went to a child psychiatry fellowship for an additional year, following which I joined the faculty at the University of Michigan. So I'm board certified in psychiatry, child and adolescent psychiatry, and in forensic psychiatry. Forensic psychiatry is that branch of psychiatry that deals with questions that come before the courts.
Okay. And tell me about your practice of psychiatry through the years.
Okay, so at the University of Michigan, I worked as a general child and adolescent psychiatrist. I also worked on a program that did a lot of custody evaluations. And then in 1993, I left the University of Michigan and came to Georgia, where I took a job as director of the Psychiatry and Law Service at Emory University in Atlanta. I tell people, in Ann Arbor, I was a child psychiatrist with an interest in forensics. In Georgia, I became a forensic psychiatrist with an interest in children. So currently, I direct the Psychiatry and Law Service at Emory that does a variety of things. We have the state contract to do the pretrial evaluations on competency and sanity for the Fulton County Courts, among other things. As a child psychiatrist, I also get involved in cases that involve children and adolescents quite a bit.
Okay. And are you published in the area of child psychology, psychiatry?
Yes. Yeah, I'm currently a professor at Emory. I've published over 50 papers and chapters and professional textbooks.
Have you served on any boards or associations in that field, particularly forensic?
Yes. I'm pretty active in professional organizations. I've been the president of the Georgia Psychiatric Physicians Association. I've been the president of the Georgia Council on Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. And I've been the president of the American, American Forensic Association. The American Academy of Psychiatry and the Law is its exact name. I've worked on a number of committees. Currently, I'm a member of the Georgia Board to Determine Bar Fitness. This is an appointment by the Georgia Supreme Court, which puts me on the committee that looks at the fitness of people who want to be lawyers and take the bar exam, essentially.
Okay.
So I've done a variety of other things that I could expand on, but I think that's the essence of it.
Have you contributed to textbooks in the field of child psychiatry?
Yes, I'm the co-editor of the leading textbook in child and adolescent forensic psychiatry, and I've written chapters in quite a number of textbooks.
State tenders this witness as an expert in child psychiatry.
I'm sorry, any objection, Mr. Winbush?
No
objection. Mrs. Winbush?
No objection.
All right, he will be so admitted. Thank you.
Well, tell us, what is a forensic examination of a child?
So a forensic examination is an examination used to address a legal question. So involving a child, the first question, if someone sends you a case, is to ask, well, what is the question you want answered? And then you do a psychiatric examination aimed primarily at answering that question.
Did you conduct a psychiatric forensic examination of Ricardo Winbush Jr.?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Would you tell us, first of all, what background information you obtained in order to prepare yourself for this investigation?
Sure. So prior to my seeing Ricardo, I did a number of things. I reviewed a variety of treatment records of various mental health people that Ricardo had seen after being removed from his home. I looked at a variety of legal records pertaining to the case. I looked at some school records. I looked at a record, at a letter he had written to his parents, and I looked at some police reports and other investigative reports, including a video interview of Ricardo that was done when he was 13. Having done that, I then got some other background information. I talked to his aunt and uncle, with whom he is still, with whom he was living at that point, on the telephone. I spoke to the guardian ad litem, who was appointed. I asked his aunt and uncle to fill out a questionnaire, which is basically a questionnaire you give to parents that ask them to rate the various symptoms that the child might have about whether they're present or not. So that's pretty much, I think, what I did prior to actually seeing Ricardo.
Okay, all this information that you gathered, is this information that you would normally rely upon in the field of psychiatry in order to conduct such a forensic interview?
Yes, this is very typical. You get background information before you actually see the person.
Okay. Did you have an interview with Ricardo Wimbush Jr.?
I did.
When and where did that occur?
So I saw him on July 5th of last year, 2016. I saw him for about 2.5 hours, and I saw him at his aunt and uncle's home.
Okay. And will you describe that interview for the jury, please?
Yes. The beginning of the of a forensic interview is I spelled out to him who I was, what I was doing, why I was there, that sort of thing. In particular, that I'd been retained by the prosecution to do a psychiatric evaluation. I made clear I wasn't there to provide any treatment to him. I was just there to do this evaluation, and that there was no confidentiality in the evaluation, that I would likely be writing a report and sending it, and so anything he told me I might put in the report if I thought it was relevant. And in addition, that there was a possibility that I would testify in this case, and that anything he told me, if I got asked about, I would have to just answer the questions. I also told him that he didn't have to answer any of my questions. He wasn't being forced to do this. I said that if he didn't answer a question, I'd probably be curious as to why he didn't answer a question, but he didn't have to. And then I asked him essentially to sign a form basically that went over some of that information, indicating that he understood it. And he was fine with all that and happy to talk to me. And then when I talked to him, I basically started out focusing on what it was like when he was in the basement for about those 18 months or period.
That this falls within an exception to the hearsay rule, so I note your objection for the record. However, it's overruled.
I'm objecting to the fact that it is hearsay because he does not have personal knowledge that Ricardo was in the basement.
Your objection is overruled and noted for the record. Thank you.
So do you want me to just talk about the process of the interview or go through what he actually said to me as well?
Yes, please. Yes, both.
Okay. So we started out, and he told me he was in the basement for about this year and a half, and that he'd actually been in before and had run away and was brought back by the police. And a lot of my interview was talking to him about what that was like for that 18 months. I was trying to get a picture of what his experience of it was. And what he said was that he really spent much of the time constantly thinking about wanting to be upstairs with his family. I'm assuming you've heard about the basement. He told me a little about the basement. I'd seen pictures down there. There was just a bed. There was no light. There was practically nothing to do. And he could come out. His parents would come down and bring him food and let him go to the bathroom. But otherwise, he had a jug there that he urinated in, and there was some writing on the wall. But he really didn't have any books or other things to entertain himself with. So what he described to me was that he spent a lot of time sitting at the door with his ear to it, trying to hear what was going on in the family upstairs, and imagining himself being up there. He said this was pretty lonely. He said it was kind of sad. He felt left out. He could hear. other members of the family a lot of the time, and he wanted to be part of it. And then I asked him, okay, could he tell me what else he did or thought about while he was down there? And what was striking to me is that he really couldn't identify anything else he really thought about or did. It was like if he wasn't there with his ear to the door thinking about being with the family, his mind was just kind of empty. And I mean, I asked him, did he make up things and, you know, write on the walls or keep track of the days or any of that? And his answer was really no. All he could really identify when he spoke to me as to what was on his mind was this kind of longing to be with his family, which he found quite painful. We then talked about what he made of all this when he was down there. What was he down there for? He wasn't very clear about even what he was there for. He said, well, he'd taken a book and a DVD, and he thought that had something to do with it, but he really wasn't clear. I asked him what he thought about what's going on, and in particular, did he ask his parents any questions about why he was down there, how long he would be there? And he said no, which, frankly, I found kind of surprising. So I was asking, well, why not? I mean, you're down there, you want to be upstairs. How come you don't ask your parents? And he basically described that two kinds of things. One was he was afraid that if he asked, he'd get beaten, that this would be seen as some kind of transgression. And that stopped him. And the second was that as time went on, he really didn't think, he just didn't think about it. He really, in his head, it was just sort of that's where he was, and he didn't want to go. He said that, you know, he was raised to do what, not to question his parents and to do what they said. So there was this kind of remarkable passivity and just going along with it without other thoughts. I wondered if he, for example, was angry at his parents, and he said no. And I said, well, can you tell me a time that you've ever felt angry at anybody? And he said no. And I should point out that his emotional tone through my interview with him was pretty flat, pretty much all the time. Not a lot of variation. At various points, for example, I tried to make some jokes or, you know, we'd be talking about some other things, not about this. You know, he never laughed, very rare, little bit of a smile, but not much of that at all. Just pretty flat, not thinking about it, feeling lonely, and this kind of poignant picture of his ear pressed to the door for a long, long time. One of his parents, I think his mother, but I'm not positive, had written some large letters on the wall, pride and humble, and I asked him what he thought about that. And he said, well, he didn't really think about that much. And he did point out to me on one of the pictures that there were some other words that came off. It was sort of like an acronym, and so there'd be pride in large letters, but then for P, he'd say presumption, prejudice, little writing. He said he looked at the stuff, but he didn't think about it. I asked it because my understanding of the room was there was a window. The window was covered with white paper, so you couldn't see out, but light would come in. And it looked like the sort of thing would be easy enough to break it. So I asked, had he thought about running away? And he said no, he didn't. He just accepted being there. We did talk a little bit about before the basement was locked. Sometime before that, he actually had been in the basement when it was unlocked, and he had run away, was found by the police, and brought back to his home, which I think entered into his ideas of what would happen if he tried running away again.
If I can interrupt you, did he relate any other events that led to the running away? Anything that had happened between him and his parents that led to that?
Yes, my understanding, and I must say, I'm not totally clear of the chronology, because he was a little vague about it, but was that he had been upstairs and had been beaten by his father, and was, by beaten, he said he was hit with a belt about 30 or 40 times, and that he was afraid that this was going to happen again, and that seemed to be the precipitant for his running away.
And what did he do to receive that punishment, do you recall?
I asked him, and he was unclear what that original punishment had been for. Some of the records said that his parents had been concerned that he had touched inappropriately some of his younger siblings. But when I talked to him, he wasn't clear that that was the reason for it.
Okay. What about, is there anything in reference to a DVD player that you talked with him about?
Yeah, the DVD player, as I understand it, came, so he was in the basement for a while for, according to the records, touching a child inappropriately. He didn't know. At that point, he could still come up at some times. Then there was the running away. After that, he was down in the basement, but it was still unlocked, as I understood it. And during that time, he came up and at some point took a DVD, and either a DVD player, and either at the same time or a different time, wasn't totally clear, took a book. And that was discovered, and according to the records, that seemed to be the precipitant then for their locking the door in the basement so he wouldn't come up and take things.
Was there any correlation in time between this alleged touching and the being put in the room? How much time span did any records in reference to that frame out?
I don't recall seeing any clear. My sense from some of the records was that was the precipitant. He did that, so he went to the basement as punishment for that. But he didn't know, he couldn't put those things together, so I didn't have a sense of that.
In talking with him about the touching, did you talk with him at length about that?
I talked to him just a little bit. I'm not sure. I'd have to check my report. I don't think he recalled it very much. I could be wrong about that, but that was my sense. At the point I talked to him, he was pretty vague about when a lot of these things had happened and what had happened.
Okay. Did you have any way of discovering to any degree of certainty whether or not that actually ever happened?
I don't know if it actually happened. He did have an evaluation subsequently about sexual interests, and there was nothing abnormal. The psychosexual evaluation was normal. So
he showed no deviance, no predisposition
right
to molestations whatsoever?
Correct. That he didn't, yes, that's correct. There was nothing later that suggested that he was at any risk for doing such things in the future was really what it was for.
Okay, do sometimes smaller children engage in that activity without any sort of malicious intent?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, when I was a kid, they called it playing doctor, and it was quite common, and is, in fact, quite common still.
Okay. All right.
So that was the main sense of what we talked about. I did ask him where his parents were currently, and he knew they were in jail, charged with child abuse. And I asked him what he wanted to have happen, and he said he wanted to go home and live with his family. And I said, okay, well, imagine that that happens, that you do go home, you live with your family, you do something wrong, and your parents say they're going to send you to the basement. What would you do? And he said he wouldn't want to go. And I said, well, what would you do? And he said he would tell somebody about it. And I said, well, what would he do if he thought that telling someone would lead to his parents going back to jail? And he said then he'd go to the basement, that he was willing to sacrifice his freedom for his parents staying out of jail. So then I talked to him then about basically how things went, had gone for him after he got out of the basement, how they were going for him now. He started attending school, and obviously he'd been homeschooled up to that point, so that was really the first time he went to school, and in a public school, and the first time he really had much interaction with other kids his age, because prior to that, my understanding was there's a lot of interaction between the brothers and sisters, but they had very little relationship with other people. And he said that went okay, and I said, well, that must have been a big change to go from the basement to a group home first and then school. And he said, I get used to things kind of quickly. So I thought that was interesting. Then I asked him how things were going living with his aunt and uncle, and he said they were going pretty well. He said he had some friends, talks to them at school. He did not see his friends at all outside of school. He didn't have a girlfriend. He saw his brothers and sisters infrequently, but sometimes, and said that went fine, but he actually didn't talk to him on the phone. He liked basketball, and in fact, when I asked him if he could do anything in the world, what would he find the most fun? He said, play basketball. In general, and then I did a kind of general screen for psychiatric symptoms and how he was thinking. And on that, I would say his mood was kind of as I described. It was very flat, but he said he wasn't depressed. He'd never felt suicidal. He'd never done anything like that. He didn't see himself as depressed. It was just sort of okay. He didn't see himself as overtly anxious. He basically thought things were going along reasonably well. He was sleeping, getting no nightmares, getting along okay with the other kids and in the house.
Let's go back to school for just a moment. When he started school, how did he come out on grade level?
I think initially he was behind. He said he was pretty behind in math and had problems in language arts. By the time I saw him, he had pretty much caught up. He was getting A's and B's and doing reasonably well.
Okay. All right, go ahead.
So I think as far as the content of the interview with him, that basically covers it.
Yes. Okay. Now, what sort of effect did this environment put on his development as a preteen and early teen?
Right. So that's a difficult question, and it's difficult because first, I don't have a lot of information about how he was functioning before he was sent to the basement. And secondly, his upbringing was very unusual before that, in that, as I understood it from him and from the records, he had very little relationship with people outside the family. So he really didn't know what normal kids his age who went to school were like. He didn't know how sort of the culture works for most of us, because he grew up in this narrow culture, largely screened off from what normal culture for a kid growing up in the United States is like. That being the case, it's hard for us to know just what one would normally expect from this kind of upbringing. What I do think is that, nevertheless, this stay in the basement had a lot of effects on him. First of all, I think it was, you know, as I described, he was lonely and all that, and poignantly wanting to be with people for extended periods of time. Secondly, he was, for that year and a half, really deprived of interaction with anybody other than very intermittently with his parents. And that's a period of important, you know, 11, 12, 13 are critical times in adolescent development. Early adolescence is the time when kids normally are getting a sense of who they are. They're starting to feel more separate from their family. They're pursuing their own interests. They're shifting a lot of their emotional energy to relationships with peers. So all of that he couldn't do. The other point about it was really what I saw is this marked sort of passivity and acceptance with what sounded like a pretty dreadful situation to be in. You know, a lot of kids, certainly if they had experience with other people, they'd be challenging the parents, you know, why am I down here? Da, da, da. He kind of blocked all that out. And just his view was, he didn't word it this way, but my putting it together, was he's just going along with what there is. And he's not questioning it at all. Now, if you're in his situation of being in the basement, that's actually a pretty adaptive way to do it. I mean, you feel better just going, since you can't change it, you feel better going along with it than you do, you know, if you're protesting and upset all the time, because then you're sitting there really miserable and angry and furious and frustrated and all of that. To just kind of go along with it is a way of coping that in that situation makes a certain amount of sense. Not that he made a conscious choice, but if you look at psychological adaptation, that makes some sense. However, when you're not in that situation, then it's not a very good way to be, to just go along with what anybody tells you to do and not to think for yourself and not to think about what other people were thinking. Because I asked him, like, did you think about what your parents were thinking about in putting you down here? No. And I said, well, do you ever think about what other people are thinking? No. I've asked a bunch of questions. You know, have you thought about why I'm asking the questions I ask? No. So you have this really having just not thinking about what other people are thinking. That's, you know, in normal life, that's not good. So he's these ways he coped with the situation while in some ways adaptive if you're in the basement and can't get out and have to live with that, are not adaptive in normal life and in life going forward. And yet he exhibits those traits very strongly. The not feeling angry at people, and it limits your emotional life. I mean, you just, you know, smiling and laughing isn't much part of it at all. And the parents said he still doesn't ask for things. For example, they gave an example that... the aunt and uncle gave me an example. He had apparently gotten sick, thrown up in his bed, you know, into the bed, so it was all sort of a mess. And he didn't tell him. He just, you know, he didn't go to him for help. Another example he gave me was they had an electronics thing. I think it was one of the video game type players. And the batteries, and that was something he enjoyed doing around the time that I was seeing him. And the batteries went dead. And rather than ask somebody, how do I get some batteries, he just did without it for like weeks and weeks. And then finally someone discovered that it wasn't working and asked him about it. He said, well, the batteries are dead. So they said, oh, here's some batteries. And then he could go back to playing it. So this kind of, you know, he being inhibited in even doing things that he enjoyed is a striking thing. So I think his development was markedly interfered with in those regards. And those are some of the symptoms we go see going forward. These symptoms don't fall neatly into any psychiatric diagnosis. It's not like saying this is a diagnosis of X, but more it's these personality traits that are, you know, are certainly cutting down on his enjoyment of life now, and I think are going to be a big problem going forward. He'd be, you know, he's prone to being exploited by other people in the future.
How common is it for abused children to want to return to the home where they were abused?
That's very common. We see that all the time.
Why is that?
Well, the leading theory is that people become attached to their caregivers, and even if that care has a lot of negative features, they're still attached. So you see this, it's very common that kids want to go back. A colleague of mine did a big study in California where they actually took kids who'd been abused and neglected and randomly assigned them to either go home or to go to foster care. And the kids in foster care did better. They would say they were doing better, and they would say they wanted to go home nevertheless. That is, that they would rather be home than be in a situation that they actually knew was better for them in all kinds of ways. So it's very striking. This phenomenon is quite common.
Did Ricardo ever indicate that he himself believed that he was not ready to come out of the room?
No, he never said he wasn't ready.
Okay.
Not to me.
All right. So when he ran away, can you tell the motivation behind that and what that tells you about his position there?
Well, when he ran away, as I said, his main, what he said primarily was that he was doing it to avoid a beating. Then when he spoke to the police, at first he wouldn't give them his name at all, then ultimately did. It was striking that he didn't tell the police that he was being kept in the basement. So they never heard about it. I think partly that can be understood as because he had been raised pretty much without relationships with people outside the family, he really didn't know that it was all that abnormal to be in a basement as a punishment. I mean, he knew his siblings weren't doing it, but he didn't have, normal, what most kids know is sort of normal life to compare anything to. So for him, that was just the way the world worked, and that's how it was.
When in the basement, what would be his approach towards communicating with his parents concerning something that they would disapprove of?
Well, I had the impression after he was locked in the basement, he really didn't communicate. I mean, he was afraid to ask questions, tell them anything, complain. He just thought that would make things worse.
Would he have been willing to agree with whatever his parents said at that time?
Yes. I mean, he said that he was taught to do what your parents say and not question it.
Okay. So what about the years that he was in there, 12, 13, those developmental years? Is the impact on a child of those years different than, say, if this had happened to a 18-year-old or a 20-year-old?
Sure. In child psychiatry, we think in terms of development, and at different ages, kids are dealing developmentally with different issues. And so at this kind of around puberty, early adolescence, kids are typically being more independent, knowing their own thoughts, creating their own identity, shifting towards interest in peers as opposed to just being in the family. And another thing we haven't talked about is that it's also around puberty, one's body is changing, and kids are coming to terms with that. And one of the ways, as a boy particularly, you learn about your body changing is because physically, often you're quite active at that point, interested in sports and that sort of thing. And he really didn't have an opportunity to do that. I mean, here he is in this small room. There's no physical, exercise. I did ask him. It's not like he instituted an exercise program for himself down there. And in fact, talked about when he got out, he was really quite weak. That had to f-
fortunately, it looks like a lot of that has come back, and now he enjoys basketball, so he's getting himself back on track. But at this crucial developmental time, and also you're starting to form your personality, and that's where I think this passivity and going along and not thinking about how other people think was really starting to take root.
So the cause that occurred during this time span, it produced that in his personality that will likely follow him in the future because it occurred during developmental time?
Yes. I mean, it was happening there. Now, we don't know, or I don't know, what his personality was like prior to that. So it's hard to know. This may have sort of aggravated tendencies in his personality that were already there, but certainly one would expect it aggravated them considerably because of the amount of deprivation that he suffered.
In the future, Doctor, will his relationships and his happiness be affected by what happened during this vital time in his life?
In my opinion, absolutely, yes.
No other questions.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to power through this witness and then we'll take our lunch break, and I'll give you sufficient time for your lunch after this witness. Mr. Wimbush, any questions?
Good afternoon, Dr. Ash.
Good afternoon.
During your interview with Ricardo, did you ever ask him what he was like before he went to the basement?
I think so. He was fairly vague about it. I know that I did look into that. I didn't get what I would say is a clear picture of what his personality was like prior to his going to the basement.
You didn't include that in your report, okay. Have you ever talked with his parents?
With his parents?
Yes.
His biological parents?
Yes, biological.
No, I have not.
Okay. Wouldn't you say you need that to have a fair, to do a fair evaluation to see what he was like and, you know, okay, what it was like beforehand, who he was beforehand?
That would have been interesting information given the circumstances of this evaluation. It just didn't seem to be an option.
Did you ask the father's family about what Ricardo's father was like growing up?
Ask the aunt and uncle what you were like?
Yes.
Not very much. I did ask them what their relationship with Ricardo was before all this happened. And they said they had seen him very, very little and really couldn't say anything.
Okay. Did you gather any background information on the parents?
Not a lot, only that which might have been in some of the investigative reports that came to me.
Did you ask little Ricardo what he was like before he went to the basement?
As I said, I tried to get some history, but he really didn't have much history to give me.
Okay. Did he tell you he lied?
Did he tell me he lied? No, he didn't.
Okay. Did he tell you he falsely accused his siblings of doing things that, or possibly broke things and blame it on someone else?
No, he didn't tell me that.
Okay. He said when he ran away, he said he was beaten with a belt for about 30 or 40 times by his father. He was beaten with his fist. He told someone else he was beaten with his fist. He told you it left bruises when he was beaten.
Yes, he said there were bruises.
Okay.
It wasn't, let me correct that. It wasn't clear to me that he was saying there were bruises in that incident, but he did say at some point there were times when he was beaten that there were bruises.
Did you know that Ricardo participated in karate, gymnastics, t-ball, baseball, dance classes, any of those things?
Before he went to the basement?
Yeah.
No, I didn't know that.
Did Did he tell you at one point in time while he was in the basement that his mother asked him to write a letter to his siblings?
He didn't tell me that, but it sort of rings a bell as something I may have read somewhere in the record.
Okay. You described Ricardo as being emotionally flat, not wondering about what others thinking. Is it possible he's always been that way?
It's possible. I think it's unlikely, but it's possible.
Thank you for the time.
All right, thank you. Mrs. Wimbush, questions for Dr. Ash?
Yes. A lot of what you said, and you covered something very important in the beginning, and you made it very clear. I did not know Ricardo. You stated that you did not know Ricardo before the alleged time that he spent inside of the basement. And you said that that affects, that impacts the, does that impact the certainty of your evaluation? And how does that impact it?
Well, the main way it impacts it is on the question of what is the relevance and what is the weight of what happened to him in the basement. How does that play in a certain, as far as a cause for the prognosis? That is, I'm not sure that's clear. So I think my evaluation, I came away with a picture of, I have a pretty good picture in my mind about how he is now, okay? I have a pretty good picture, I think, about what happened in the basement, how he experienced that. When you say, okay, what's he going to be like going forward, it would, you said, well, he was like all the ways I described before he went into the basement, then, okay, then that loads him for being that way now and going forward. It will make it harder for him to change if, in fact, he was that way before. I think that what happened in the basement aggravated it. If that way of being was there before, it helped solidify it. But exactly how much you're going to say was from the way he was before, how much comes from the basement, that's hard.
Okay.
So that's the issue. In terms of how he felt about being in the basement, what his suffering was like then, it doesn't play into that calculation. Is that clear? I'm not sure I made it clear.
I kind of understand.
Okay.
And you said the date of your evaluation was July 5th, 2016?
Correct.
And you said that his parents were incarcerated at that time?
That was my understanding.
Okay. And do you know if Ricardo had seen his parents from that time? And from the time that he left his home up until then?
Objection, relevance, Your Honor.
Ms. Wimbush, the court has given some instruction or guidance on this issue, and so I do not find it relevant as asked, so I do sustain the objection.
Ask it a different way. Could some of the flat effect, I don't like using flat effect. Could some of what you saw or that you accredit to his time, alleged time in the basement, be related to things that occurred from the time that he left his home even to the time that you saw him?
I think those, what happened since he left the basement between then and when I saw him, obviously could have some effects on how he was feeling.
You said that while he was there, he really wanted to be with the family?
There in the basement, you mean?
Yes.
Yes, yes, he did.
And you also stated that he saw his siblings, since he has been in foster care, that he's seen his siblings very infrequently?
My sense of it is like every 6 months, but split up, they're not all at the same time.
Okay. And so do you think that that would have the same or similar effect on him, still not being able to see those siblings?
He didn't seem that distressed at not seeing his siblings much because he said he enjoyed being with them when he was with them. I said, and we had a discussion about whether or not he talked to him on the telephone, and he said, essentially, practically, I'm not sure he ever did, but certainly not frequently. And I said, why not? You know, he could have. I mean, he, you know, could use the phone. He just didn't have that much interest in doing it, so.
So when you go out to do an evaluation, or a forensic examination, as you called it, is it typical that you're looking to make mental health, if you will, diagnosis?
What I'm most focused on is answering the particular forensic question that gets asked. Typically, I will also look at diagnostic issues. Not always, but typically.
Okay, because I noticed that you said he didn't have any depressive or disorders. What other things did you examine him for?
So I looked particularly at issues of depression, issues of anxiety, and issues of post-traumatic stress disorder. And I didn't think he met the diagnostic criteria for any of those.
For any of
I
those.
Did think he, there were personality factors, but making personality diagnoses in adolescence is complicated and a little iffy.
Understand that. If I told you that Ricardo, that the way in which you describe Ricardo is almost identical to his dad, would that change your evaluation?
No.
No?
I mean, it would be a piece of information, but it wouldn't change how I see him as being or how I think he experienced his time in the basement.
Okay. You talked about Ricardo being adaptive, that he was able to just go along with how things were. Do you consider that a positive or negative characteristic?
As I said, it has pros and cons. I think in the situation he was in the basement, it leads to less suffering than most people would have. In terms of, I don't know if suffering is the right word, it, certainly less anger, frustration, those kinds of emotions. So it's moderately adaptive in that situation. Going forward in the real world, it's not adaptive and has all kinds of drawbacks. It opens you to exploitation from others. You are limited in your interpersonal relationships if you really never think about how the other person is thinking. And there are a lot of drawbacks to it in normal life, for lack of a better expression.
Would a normal occurrence, such as not being able to do something to someone and not care about how they feel, is that similar to what you're speaking about? Is that
when you say do something to someone because you don't care about how they feel, like, that kind of is usually people who are angry, you know, hurt. It implies sort of a hurtfulness. And from his description, he just doesn't experience anger much at all, or at least he said he didn't. And that's not so adaptive. I mean, there are times when anger is adaptive, and not to feel it is a real problem.
You said you viewed, and I don't know how much you remember of it, you said you viewed Ricardo's interview with the police detective, is that correct?
I don't think it was a police detective, I think it was someone from the Department of Family and Child Services, but I'm not exactly positive who did it, but I saw that an interview where he described what happened to him and so on.
That's okay, doctor. You need to be asked a question to respond further.
Okay.
Do you recall in a video, Ricardo being at, in that video, if this is the video, do you recall being Ricardo being asked if he had put his fingers in his sister's vaginas?
I think it was in there. I don't recall his response at this point.
Okay, you don't recall his response?
No.
Okay. Do you recall a change in, when you watched the video, did you recall, did you notice a change in Ricardo's demeanor when that question got asked of him?
I don't recall it at this point. I might have at the time, but I don't know.
Do you have any experience evaluating or treating homeschool children?
Yes.
Excuse me, which
kind? Homeschool. You said you do have experience?
Yes.
And what kind of experience do you have?
It's come up in a number of evaluations I've conducted that kids were homeschooled. As far as treatment, maybe a little bit, but not that much. But it's come up.
Did Ricardo indicate to you that he was afraid of his parents?
Not currently. He was, the only way a fear of his parents came up was in the context of he was afraid if he did ask questions or those sorts of things, he might get a beating, and he was afraid of that. Other than that, no.
You associated, you said Ricardo doesn't ask for things. Could that be related to a sense of pride in that one does not want to ask for things?
It could be, but I didn't think it was with him. With him, it seemed more an inhibition rather than a sort of I can do it myself kind of attitude.
If I told you, or if you knew, that Ricardo didn't like to ask for things and even almost drowned because he didn't want to ask for help prior to all of these instances, would that change your thoughts about it being inhibitive?
Probably not.
Probably not. Okay. Did you ask Ricardo if he had an option of returning upstairs while he was in the basement?
Well, he was in the basement, as I understood it, in two periods. When he was locked in the basement, it was not an option to go upstairs. Before the being locked, he was in the basement, and my understanding then he had some options about going upstairs periodically.
Did you ask, or did Ricardo tell you that he had an option at any point to move back upstairs?
Objection. Facts not in evidence, Ron.
Well, the witness is on cross-examination, and she can inquire of the basis of this witness opinion, so I'm going to overrule that. You can answer, Doctor.
So, in the period when he was locked in the basement, referring to that period, no, he did not tell me that he had an option to go upstairs.
Okay. Did Ricardo ever tell you that he chose to go down to the basement?
No.
Would it change your opinion if you knew that Ricardo actually chose for his room?
Objection.
To be
facts not in evidence, Your Honor.
Well,
I mean, he's been tendered as an expert. And so he can give his opinion on hypothetical situations, Mr. Mayfield. Anything else you want to say on that?
Yes, the question is not phrased in a hypothetical question.
All right,
the question was phrased as if it happened, and that's not in evidence.
Well, that's a different objection.
Okay.
What is your objection?
My objection is to the form of the question.
All right, on that basis, I do sustain it. Please rephrase.
If you knew that Ricardo chose for his room to be in the basement, how would that affect your thoughts about Ricardo's stay in the basement?
Renew the objection, Your Honor.
Sustained. do not find that your question is formed in a hypothetical, so I can sustain the objection.
In your expert opinion, how would you view such behaviors in a child, in your expert opinion, I'm sorry, let me change that question. What would your recommendation be for a child who is sexually offending or violating the privacy of his siblings, of their siblings?
Objection, relevancy, Your Honor.
Well, there's been some testimony on that subject brought out, but I'm going to ask you to rephrase your question because it is overly broad. So narrow your question, please.
Dr. Ash mentioned that he had read reports.
You can't question the court. So I'm sustaining Mr. Mayfield's objection. I'll give you an opportunity to rephrase and narrow the scope of your question if you wish to do so.
Hypothetically, Dr. Ash, if there is a child in a home that is offending their siblings in a sexual fashion, what would your recommendation be for the parents as it pertains to the other children?
I would recommend that the parents obtain an evaluation of the child to understand what was going on and what the risk was and that sort of thing.
And if they show that they had no risk, for example, from a psychosexual evaluation, but however they were still doing those things, what would your recommendation be for that particular child?
Well, if they're still doing it, there's clearly risk. So I can't really deal with that. I mean, if someone's done it and done it recently, there is clear risk, and then you have to assess what that risk is, how best to manage it, that sort of thing.
Okay, so if the risk, it could a risk factor just be curiosity?
Well, that goes into, you evaluate it and you see what it, you know, what's driving it. I mean, as I said, if it's simply, you know, a kind of childhood exploration, then largely the first intervention is kind of education. You talk to the child about it, what he's doing, and point out it's inappropriate, and, you know, educate them about why it's inappropriate, in a sense. If that works, then fine, you're done. If it doesn't, then other steps need to be taken.
Okay.
So that's why it gets to, you really have to look at it in all its fullness to understand what's going on before you can say, this is what I would do about it.
Understood. I don't have any further questions, thank you.
Redirect, Mr. Mayfield.
Briefly. Based upon everything you know about this, including the psychosexual exam, if any touching of siblings occurred, in your opinion, would it be just the typical child curiosity?
Well, from what I've heard, that's what it looks like at face value, but until you really get into it, you can't be sure.
And can a child exercise that curiosity even at an age before they know what sexuality is?
Oh, yes. I mean, that's quite common, that a lot of this play is sort of exploratory as opposed to what we think of as adult sexuality.
Okay. No other questions.
Ms. Wimbush?
Dr. Ash, so if, for instance, a child, say, inappropriately touches their sibling, and then they're told that's not the right thing to do, and then they do it again, then what would be your recommendation?
Well, it's still a matter of, you have to evaluate the child and see if you can understand what's going on from the child's point of view. What are they thinking about when they're doing it? What does this mean? And then once you have that information, then you're in a position to say, okay, well, the way to manage it is whatever.
And then if they continuously do that, then what?
Well, if they're actually molesting other children, you have to have an intervention that protects the other child. But what that is highly variable depending on the nature of the situations, I mean.
Thank you.
Ms. Wimbush.
I don't have any further questions.
All right.
One question.
Yes.
And if that were all true, is the appropriate intervention ever to lock them in a room for 18 months?
No.
No other questions.
All right. Can this witness be excused from his any further testimony? Mr. Mayfield?
Yes, Your Honor.
Mr. Wimbush?
Yes.
Ms. Wimbush?
Yes.
All right, thank you, Dr. Ash. You're excused.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, at this time we are going to recess for our lunch break. Without fully reading the precautionary instructions, I'll remind you of the precautionary instructions that you have been given throughout this trial. We will resume at 145. Mr. Mayfield, anything for the record before the lunch recess?
Yes, Your Honor. I think I need to clarify for the record. Because it comes apparent to the state that there was a misunderstanding between the court and the district attorney's office. When we were discussing on the record